Hello and welcome back to Odds on La Liga. Match day 10, international break is over. We have El Clásico in only 7 days and we have very good games in this match day with Álvaro Romeo here to analyze with us this match day. Álvaro, how are you doing?
Very well, thank you, Edu. Very well. Looking forward to another La Liga week. I think that there are good games this weekend, and also La Liga has been a bit more flashy than in the previous seasons. We have seen many goals, 30 in the last round, 30 in the penultimate round as well, which is a good average to La Liga standard. So let's try to make some money.
And we have Sevilla with a new manager. We have to talk a lot about this Sevilla-Real Madrid, probably the best game in this match day together with Barça Athletic. So guys, remember to leave your comments, press the like, subscribe, and now let's go on with the show. And also remember that we have a partnership with 1xBet. So if you are looking for a bookie to sign up, we have an exclusive offer with them, 130% in your welcome bonus. This is an exclusive offer. You won't find it anywhere else. So use our promo code, our link, and get this offer. Álvaro, first game is Osasuna-Granada, and we went into the international break with the big surprise of Granada leading 2-0 against Barcelona with an exhibition of Brian Zaragoza, a player that you've named several times in this show. At the end, Granada grabbed only a point because their problem is that they concede a lot of goals, 23 goals conceded. This season, Osasuna faced the other giant in La Liga, and they were smashed by Real Madrid at Bernabeu.
Yeah, this game for me points me in the direction of the goals market, and I tell you why. Because I think that, yes, Osasuna hasn't been good at home this season. Not. They haven't been good at all. But on the other hand, I'm pretty sure that they can score against Granada because Granada conceded many goals. Concedes so many that they have already received 23. And that's a crazy amount, 23 goals, only Almeria has conceded one more. And even when Granada plays well, they end up like giving away one or two. So it looks like a little bit of a recurrent factor and recurrent habit that Granada concedes. And since I believe that Osasuna finally are going to start being competitive because they have started the season so-so, but even though they have started not in the best possible way, they have still been okay. I mean, at the end of the day, they've got 10 points. And, you know, it was a slow start. But to their standards, it was, you know, something that is not very worrisome. There is not much to worry about. They are still on time to revert the situation a little bit. So I'm going to go for the goals market. And I know as well that Granada can score because they got players like Brian Zaragoza, for example, who has so many goals and dribbles this season that it's impossible not to think that Granada will create the chances. So I'm going to go for over 2.25 goals. That pays 170. And then if you like both teams to score, go for both teams to score, obviously. But I prefer this one, this market, really, because it doesn't suppress or disqualify any team if they play very badly. Because with over 2.25 goals, you just have to expect three goals. And it can be three from Osasuna, it can be two from Granada and one from Osasuna. You know, it equates, in a way, both teams to score. But for me, it offers more certainty. So I'm going for this one. I love it. 170.
Well, Osasuna, you've mentioned that they've been poor at home. They are the worst home team in La Liga. Only 1 point, only one goal scored. The problem is Granada is also among the worst teams as a visitor in La Liga. Only 1 point as well and 12 goals conceded, but they are able to score. 7 goals scored away already. For Granada, this is the Friday evening game on Saturday. Very good games starting in San Sebastian, Real Sociedad, Mallorca. We left Real Sociedad in a very good form before the international break. It's true that they lost against Atletico de Madrid, but Perhaps they deserve more. They were very angry with the referee as well. Even in the Champions League, they are showing a very good level. We are seeing Oyarzabal also scoring. Whereas for Mallorca, Álvaro, a team that is drawing a lot. Only one victory this season, it was away, and they are coming from three consecutive draws.
Yeah, they have to start winning, but at least now they don't lose the plot in the games. For example, Girona, I remember that beat Mallorca back in the day. It was mid-September, 5-3. Granada beat them 3-2. You know, lately these results haven't repeated themselves. I have seen Mallorca at least staying in the game. If they conceded, they came back, and otherwise they would score first and then receive a goal, but they were at least competitive again. Mallorca 2, Barcelona 2, Rayo Vallecano 2, Mallorca 2, and Mallorca 1, Valencia 1. This has been the last result of Mallorca, so the situation is slightly better. Of course, maybe the international break has been a little bit inconvenient for Mallorca because they've been, or they were on the app right now, and I think that they were getting a proper lift up, but anyway, they are playing against Real Sociedad, and Real Sociedad is in a better moment, that's for sure. It's not that they don't lose games, because they lost against Real Madrid, they lost against Atletico, but when they play against the teams their level, normally they tend to win, especially at home. A bit of bad news for Real Sociedad: Andrés Silva, a player who was at the end of his recovery before the international break, has suffered another injury in training, and he's going to miss a few more weeks. Tierney is still out, but still, I think that Real Sociedad has enough firepower and enough number nines in the squad, like Oyarzabal, who can be a number nine, Carlos Fernández, Umar Sadik. I don't think that Real Sociedad is going to suffer so much from the injury of Andrés Silva. And maybe in this window that goes from September to November until the next international break, finally we see more of Arsène Zakarian, a player who has a great fame but hasn't played a lot for Real Sociedad yet. Look, for this game, I'm going to go for the following. Real Sociedad to win, it pays 160. And I think that is about, I wouldn't say it's a safe bet, but it's a pretty decent one, attractive for me at least, and maybe over 4.5 cards. But this market is not available yet, so wait a little bit and it will be available soon.
Okay, a bit short, no? Perhaps the odds for Real Sociedad to win 1.6, but they've been growing this season for sure, and they are the best team in this game in the Reale Arena. Next game, much more balanced, Getafe Betis, and here the bookies place Getafe as the favorite because at home they haven't lost yet, but they couldn't beat Villarreal, for instance, in the last home game despite playing against 10 men, another draw against Celta, and Betis, Álvaro, away from home, they've been poor so far. They beat Villarreal in the opening match day in this La Liga, but they were also very disappointed, for instance, against Alavés.
Yeah, they have been a little bit. I think that they are improving slightly, but they need to start winning games. All that is going to be down to them being solid. And finally, they have been a little bit more solid lately. They drew to Alavés, that was a bit disappointing. They drew to Granada away. They also drew against Cádiz at home. In between, they beat Valencia 3-0. At least you can look at it from a different perspective. They are undefeated in four. And you know, Getafe has a couple of important players missing, especially Yené Nkunam, the center back, who has already 5 yellows and he's suspended for this game. This is what happens when you play to the limit. Like Getafe does that many times. You get many players in the sidelines or suspended, and you know, you have to use the rest of your squad. Also, Domingos Duarte is going to be suspended. So, having such an important player like Yené Nkunam suspended out of this game altogether with Nsunal, who is still not ready. Look, I'm going to back Betis slightly here. With an Asian handicap plus 0.25, that pays 177. If they draw, you get half a win. If they win, you win. I know that sounds a little bit crazy, but I saw Getafe the other day suffering against Villarreal. Villarreal were with 10 men. So why not to think that Betis can do something similar, hopefully with 11 men. For Betis, there is something important that Pellegrini has been doing. He's been working a lot on the backbone of the team. He rarely drops Pechela, Guido, Isco, and Marc Roca. and William Carvalho is unavailable. So those five players are the backbone of Betis because they play basically in the central channel. And I think that Betis relies a lot on the creativity and the holding abilities of these footballers. By the way, Guido is suspended for this game, but still, I think that William Carvalho could be back. Still, I think that Betis can get something here, Edrou, for example, and players like Abde, for example, or Asan Diao can be dangerous too, especially in the counterattacks. Abde has had a very good landing in Betis, 3.6 attempts per game, and then Asan Diao has been one of the big sensations of La Liga this season. In fact, him to score pace 4.5.
Well, the other team in Sevilla, they are playing against Real Madrid at home. In the international break, they fired the manager, Mendilibar, after the draw against Rayo Vallecano at the very last minute, and they got Diego Alonso. I'm not sure if the fans are very happy with the appointment. I wouldn't be. Personally, but it's been a very slow start for Sevilla, as we all know, and now they receive the visit of Real Madrid. It was the best moment of this short season so far, Álvaro, for Real Madrid, because they were very good against Osasuna, easy victory, they beat Napoli, they are topping both the group in the Champions League and in La Liga, and now they have Alaba back, and perhaps Álvaro is a good moment to put Brahim. I'm looking forward to seeing Brahim from the start, thinking also that Vinicius and Rodrigo, they had a tough game in Montevideo that they lost, by the way.
Yeah. And Vinicius was used a lot against Uruguay, basically one of the main tactics of Brazil was giving the ball to Vinicius for him to do something. So I'm sure that he's going to be, if not tired, because Vinicius has a terrific engine, maybe he needs, you know, a little bit of a rest just to prevent injuries and things like this. Mm-hmm. Brahim can be one of the options for sure, 100%. And Brahim probably is eager to play because Arda Güler is at the end of his recovery and he will be ready for Ancelotti soon, which means that it will be more, you know, there will be more competitiveness in the squad for Brahim Díaz, unfortunately. So, you know, let's start with Sevilla, by the way, because I think the season has been poor so far. Two draws in the Champions League, that's okay, but two wins in all competitions. This season, that's why Mendilibar was sacked, Diego Alonso arrived. Diego Alonso was the coach of Uruguay during the World Cup. Diego Alonso was appointed by Uruguay about 2 years ago because the players weren't happy with Tavares and it looked like the Tavares time was over. And Diego Alonso arrived and managed to win a few consecutive games and qualify Uruguay for the World Cup. But then in the World Cup, Uruguay didn't do too well. There are a few questions that I got here. Is he going to keep Nyland in goal or is he going to give a chance to Dimitrovic? Is he going to, for example, give a chance to the younger players or is he going to be adamant with the Rakitic and Fernando holding midfield partnership? You know, these are things that I really want to see because when he arrived in Uruguay, he wanted energy in the midfield and he gave a lot of important roles to Ugarte and Fede Valverde. And I think that probably Moussa Sow is going to play a lot because normally Diego Alonso likes energy in midfield. And I think that Fernando and Rakitic together don't provide that energy. Sevilla doesn't have any injury worries, which means that possibly Mariano and definitely Sergio Ramos will be playing. And Sergio Ramos to score pace 12, by the way. If you like these stories, Edu, Sergio Ramos to score, pace 12. Unfortunately, no. that would be glorious. Put your money. When it comes to Real Madrid, look, Nacho is suspended. Alaba could be ready. If he's not, I don't know who is going to be the center back with Rudiger. Jude Bellingham made goals. We know that Real Madrid has been the best team of La Liga so far, the best, with the exception of the game against Atletico de Madrid. So my bets are the following. I'm going to offer 4 tips because I really like this game to bet. It will be the conservative one, Asian handicap minus 0.25 for Real Madrid, 163. Real Madrid to win, 192, even though I prefer the previous one. You know that I am rather conservative when it comes to betting. And I also like Real Madrid to score over 1.5 goals or over 1.5 goals in the second half. I think that this game is going to be feisty. There will be goals. And I think Real Madrid is not going to lose it.
Well, Real Madrid have won in the last five seasons in the Pizjuan. It's a tough stadium historically, but the last defeat was in 2018. We have to highlight also, of course, Bellingham also shining with the English national team. And Real Madrid, they have a tough calendar. So Sevilla, because Sevilla, they are facing Arsenal in the Champions League. And Real Madrid, they have Braga, which is okay. And then they have El Clásico in Barcelona. So this is going to be a tough test after the international break for Ancelotti's men, Sevilla, and then Barcelona. And on Saturday, Álvaro, the other team involved in the Champions League, Atlético de Madrid traveling to Balaídos. It should be an easy stadium to grab the 3 points. No victories yet for Celta playing at home with Benítez very angry with the referees. And we left also Atlético de Madrid, Álvaro, on a hype. 5 consecutive victories in all competitions after that draw that they got against Lazio in the very last minute. But despite all the injury issues and all the problems that Simeone is facing in this start of the season, I think they are doing great so far.
Yeah, they are doing well. They are doing well. And in the Champions League as well, they've got 4 points after 2 games, which is about right. Look, I think that Atletico is the favorite for this game. My favorite thought here is Atletico to score over 0.5 goals in the first half. It pays 195 and they have started the games strongly. I really think that this one is pretty attractive. But otherwise, for example, you can go for an Asian handicap of minus 0.25 for Atletico and it pays almost 2. Basically, if they draw, you suffer only half a lose. And if they win, you win. Those will be my favorite bets. I think that I will be keen to back Celta this season a bit, but maybe not today or maybe not for this game because they are playing against the top opposition. Celta is winless at home and Atletico has won in the last 3 visits to Balaídos, if that matters really, because the manager of Celta was a different one. For Atletico, look, still some injuries. Memphis is still out. Obviously, the likes of Reinildo and Lemar, they are still out as well, but at least they are recovering players like Soyuncu or Jimenez. So I'm thinking that probably Axel Witsel won't be playing in central defense because Atletico is recovering some important key members of the squad for the defensive positions. And then I would like to single out Saúl Amorata. Saúl, because he has provided 5 assists this season, so he's back. And then Álvaro Morata, because he's been scoring many goals. Basically, he scored over 10 between club and country. So congratulations to him. But as I said before, my favorite bets here will be Atletico to score in the first half, 195, or Asian handicap minus 0.25 for Atletico. They are a better team than Celta, and I think that they can prove it.
Not included that tap-in that was disallowed against Norway when the ball was going in. Very Moratish, we can say, no? That goal disallowed. Games on Sunday, first one is Las Palmas, Rayo Vallecano. Las Palmas, they are taking the pulse to the competition, back-to-back victories against Villarreal and Celta. In Serie A, Álvaro, we have Empoli with 4 points with only 1 goal. Las Palmas, 6 goals, which is not a great tally. 11 points, I think. They are doing great for the amount of goals they are scoring. They are undefeated at home, and Rayo is the king of draws. 4 consecutive draws, so perhaps we see a draw in this game.
You know, I think that perhaps we see a draw. That would be probably my most logical outcome as well. 320, a draw is not bad. But this game, I wrote it in capital letters with a big pass mark because I think that this one is difficult to call, really. My opinion is that this is going to be a low scoring game, okay? So under 2.25 goals, pays 196, and I can understand why. My opinion is that this is going to be like this. But since La Liga has been surprising me lately with many goals, and since Las Palmas has been winning lately because they got 3 wins in the last 4 games, maybe something is changing in here. By the way, as you said before, Las Palmas, they have collected a lot of points, considering how little goals they have scored this season. So they have been able to capitalize this and the little shortcomings they are getting. And that's why probably the manager signed a contract extension this week, because García Pimienta is going to be in charge, hopefully, if he doesn't get the sack until 2025. So congratulations to him. Las Palmas beat Villarreal in the last game. And Rayo, I think that they've got an okay defense. The numbers lie a little bit. They don't lie, but the numbers don't tell the whole story because they conceded 7 alone against Atletico de Madrid in one game. But otherwise, Rayo's defense has been decent, and then they are unbeaten since the 2nd of September. So both teams are coming into this game in a decent moment. Maybe under 2.25 goals could be my bet, but otherwise, as I said, I'll happily pass this one. And if you want to go to for an individual market, maybe go for a crazy one, like maybe, who knows, after this international break and some time to train with the team and get his fitness back, maybe Raúl de Tomás can score a goal. I don't know, 3.0, he could pay, but be very careful about this. Check the lineup before the game. As I said before, this could be easily a pass for me.
Okay, let's try to find better odds, perhaps, in the next game. We have Girona-Almeria. This looks like a home victory because Girona, they are really in form. They are doing a great season. After the defeat against Real Madrid, they bounce back with a victory in Cádiz. And what to say about Almeria, Álvaro? They sacked the manager, but they are not getting better. I'm sure you watched the game against Athletic, and especially they are very bad defensively. They've conceded 24 goals in only 9 games.
No. I'm going to back Girona 100%. Against Athletic Club Bilbao, I remember that some friends of mine, they were a little bit dubious and skeptical when I was telling them Athletic should beat Almeria because Almeria is very poor. Many of them, they don't watch La Liga. They just watch Athletic de Bilbao. And they were, you don't know Athletic. We always screw it up in these on paper easy games. And I told them, I think that Almeria is really, really poor this time. And on top of that, they are missing Luis Suarez for a long time. And this is a massive blow. Girona is also having some injuries. Don't get me wrong. But I think that, for example, Girona can afford missing Chigankov, as they do. But Almeria cannot afford really to lose Luis Suarez because he was having a very good season and he was clearly the best striker they had. Girona has scored in every game in La Liga except the game against Real Madrid. I think that they are going to win this game because they are better. They bounce back after losing against Real Madrid, which is what big sides do normally. Girona to win 150. It's okay, but I'm going to top it up a little bit with Girona to win and over 1.5 goals in that game, 162. Mm-hmm. I think that that bet is about correct, really.
Indeed. Let's go to the next game, Villarreal-Alavés. Really poor, this Villarreal. It looks like they are never going to take off this season because they lost to Las Palmas in Europa League. They were lucky to get the victory against Rennes. So only 2 points in the last 4 games. The change of manager has not improved the team, Álvaro, and I don't know if Pacheta could be in risk if they are not able to beat Alavés, because on paper, Villarreal should win this one.
Yes, on paper, yes. I'm going to back them slightly with an Asian handicap minus 0.25, which is 152. And I think that there are some other markets that we could check, like, for example, Villarreal to win 170. Look, I'm almost happy to get until there. Villarreal to win 170, I could risk a little bit of money and do that. But I prefer the Asian handicap minus 0.25 for them because Villarreal hasn't given me many assurances and certainties this season. On top of that, important players are out. Baena is still suspended. Coquelin, he's going to be back soon. He's back in training, but I don't think he's ready to start. The number nines of the team are not delivering. Gerard Moreno, I just want to wait and see if he can play like 4 games in a row. You know, many doubts about them. I don't think that they have the good squad they have a couple of years ago, really, when they could play up front with Danjuma, for example, and Gerard Moreno, when Pau Torres was there. So little by little, I think they are favorites, yes. So as I said before, maybe an Asian handicap minus 0.25 for Villarreal to win, but I'm not going to lie. Last season, I thought that Villarreal was a candidate to qualify for the Champions League at this moment in time, even though Unai Emery was on his way to Aston Villa. But this season, I don't see Villarreal doing that. I think Real Sociedad or Athletic Club Bilbao or even Girona are more likely to qualify for the fourth spot than Villarreal. Villarreal has had a very poor start of the season.
But really poor, to be honest. Now they are in position 16 in La Liga, only 2 points more than Celta de Vigo, and with the same points as Alavés. So, really poor for Villarreal. Let's see if they look for Marcelino, for instance. Now he's available. He was asked by Sevilla to join Sevilla when they fired Mendilibar. So perhaps Marcelino could be a replacement for Pacheta. Let's see.
Would be good.
The team doesn't react and beat Alavés. Well, on Sunday, the last game is Barça Athletic. Barcelona dropping points in Granada. They haven't been playing great, Álvaro, in the last games away from home against Mallorca, but even at home, they've been struggling. It's true that they are getting the victories, for instance, in the Champions League against Porto. But there are many question marks about Barcelona, many injuries, many absentees, also Lewandowski, De Jong, Pedri. Next in La Liga is Athletic, Real Madrid and Real Sociedad. The problem for Barcelona, let's say, to drop points in this game is that historically Athletic, they are awful playing in Barcelona's ground since 2018. They don't catch a point. The last victory, we have to go back. You know when?
2001.
Yeah. It's about to break the record, eh?
2001, really. And the previous one, it happened in 1994 with a lovely goal from Julen Guerrero, who was at the time our brightest star. But yeah, I think, look, Barcelona has many players in the sidelines, and I still deem them as favorites because Athletic Club Bilbao historically at Barcelona doesn't do too well. Also, Athletic Club Bilbao has a couple of important misses or doubts because, number one, Geray, one of probably our best defenders right now, is injured and he underwent surgery in his groin and he's going to be abductor, sorry, and he's going to be out for 3 months. And then Nico Williams is doubtful. He wasn't in the Spanish camp because he got an injury. On paper, he's recovered for the game, but I want to see if he starts or not. But the list of casualties at Barcelona is massive. You mentioned Lewandowski, Pedri, De Jong, but also Rafinha and Koundé. And maybe Balde and Lamine Yamal could be doubtful too. Still, I think that Barcelona has a better squad. They can still play with Joao Félix, with Gundogan, with Gavi, with Araujo, with Ter Stegen, you know, good footballers. So I think that Barcelona can win this game. I would like to say kudos to Gundogan for carrying the creative responsibilities of Barcelona in the absence of De Jong and Pedri. And Gavi has improved a lot. Last season, I wasn't too sure about Gavi, not about him as a footballer, but I thought that sometimes he was too pugnacious, he was fighting a lot and sometimes he wasn't that creative, but this season he's improving quite a lot, so kudos to him for making that step forward too, stepping up. So Barcelona to win would be my favorite bet, 168. I think it pays really well considering the history between Barcelona and Athletic Club Bilbao at Camp Nou. And I also like two more markets that are more risky, but I love them really. Barcelona to win and over 1.5 goals in the game, 191, or Barcelona to win the second half, 197.
A couple of names about this game, Álvaro. One is Íñigo Martínez. He's the player with less minutes in Barcelona's squad. He joined Barcelona from Athletic. And the other one is President Laporta, also in the headlines these days.
Quick with Íñigo Martínez. He will end up playing because the cup starts soon and all that. I think that Koundé has been very poor this season. Has been very poor, and he would deserve to be dropped, and Christensen and Araujo should be playing. And Íñigo Martínez right now doesn't look a worse player than Koundé. Koundé has been really, really, really poor, in my opinion. When it comes to, but you have to adapt to a team like Barcelona. I understand that Íñigo Martínez is going through an adapting curve, and let's see if Xavi trusts him a little bit more in the future, because he's a good centre-back. And when it comes to Joan Laporta, look, he's been accused, he's going to be investigated, and I don't know if the news that he's going to be investigated are going to end up with him being sentenced. I don't know about that, but the whole story looks very bad on Barcelona. It smells very bad. They haven't still been able to justify why during the Laporta stint, the Sandro Rosell stint, and the Bartomeu stint, they were paying the referees year after year for 17 years. They haven't been able to explain that. And you know, I think that the Spanish justice should try to go to the bottom of the case. And Ceferin from UEFA is monitoring all this. So let's keep an eye on this, because if Barcelona gets accused, or if, sorry, if they get sentenced finally, Ceferin could exclude Barcelona from the European competitions too. So this story is going to have some ramifications, and I am afraid that we're going to be talking about this for a long time.
Mm-hmm. Still a long shot, of course, but it's going to be in the headlines for really, really long time. And for Monday, we have one extra game, Valencia-Cádiz, with Valencia with 11 points in a bad run. Both teams, actually, they are in a bad run. Four winless games for Valencia, also really depleted the team. And Cádiz, they lost to Girona. Machís was sent off. Machís, a player that should be very happy after Venezuela beat Chile in this international break, but he's been out of the team because he was sent off. 2 points only for Cádiz in the last five games, Álvaro.
Yeah, I back Valencia slightly with an Asian handicap minus 0.25. It pays 153. I know that Valencia right now is not a club that I can trust any more than that. Otherwise, I'm going to back Valencia with Asian handicap corners this time, a market that sometimes I like for this game. I think that Valencia is going to attack more. Valencia has a more attacking-minded approach, that's for sure. They've got young players who go to the byline, try to dribble, they will provoke corners. Asian handicap corners minus 1.5 for Valencia, 166. Hopefully, Valencia will arrange their defensive problems soon, because Gaya could be out for this game. Sergi Canós, who can play as a right back, is doubtful. You know, they have to recover players like Marie, for example, who can be important in defense as well. But still, all in all, I think that Valencia is slightly better. I am totally aware that they got only 2 points out of the last 12. So they are in a bad run. And in that run, they have been 2 games scoreless as well. But they are playing at home, and I think that they have the means and the capacity to get something from Cádiz.
Mm-hmm. Well, Álvaro, this is it for this new match day in La Liga. From the international break, then we have the Champions League, and in the middle we have this interesting match day. Tell me your safe bet for these games.
Yeah, it will be Asian handicap minus 0.25 for Barcelona, 147.
And Yoraka?
Mallorca, it will be Asian handicap minus 0.25 for Real Madrid. Girona to win, Asian handicap minus 0.25 for Barcelona. Total 359.
The top three teams in La Liga to win, in your opinion. This is your ACA. Tell me in the comments your ACA, guys, and see you very soon. Thanks for watching. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.